American is a wonderful thing, but being free as a Christian is a greater thing. Having our spirit free, praise God, go home tonight, and I can go to bed. I don't have to worry about getting up in the morning with a hangover. I get up in the morning with joy unspeakable and full of glory in my soul. And it's all because of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. You know, we were talking about our country this morning, about America, and our mind goes back to the many experiences we've had in this great country of ours by way of blessing. We can never count all the blessings that we have had in this great country of ours. They are absolutely above any number we could ever name, the blessings God's given to us in America. I want to say tonight that I believe God's people need to get right with God. I believe that it's God's people holding back revival. I believe that God's people, many of God's people, don't have God on their mind like they ought to have. Other things occupy their mind. My friend, we find that, you know, years ago, America was known as the land of the free. It is still called that by a lot of patriots like myself. It is a land of the free, and it is a land of love and compassion and concern, and we have helped other countries. I mean multiple countries, many, many countries we've given money to. We still are. And some of these places our money is going doesn't belong there.
Right.
We're giving it away, and we're not giving it to the right people in the right places. And again, in my opinion, and I keep saying my opinion because you may disagree with some of this stuff, but if I hit the Bible now, you can't disagree with that. The word stands no matter who likes it and who doesn't. But I know now that this country of ours, I've seen it go from freedom and my land of freedom and great blessings from God, still blessed to a certain extent, but it is also a land that is losing freedoms fast. We're losing our freedoms and we don't even realize it. We've had it good, so good in this country so long that we don't see the devil that has come in unawares and has disrupted our great nation. My friend, false religions are everywhere. Religion everywhere, but not too many people are dedicated, consecrated Christians that love the Lord Jesus and put him first in their life. We have liberal schools. We have liberal teachers. They're teaching to hate America, that America's a bad place. But my friend, because they are in a land now, and this land is turned into a land of haters, God haters. They don't like the Bible. They don't want us to preach the Word of God. They think that, and we do. We do interfere with them. We interfere with their agenda. We upset their apple cart, so to speak. When you preach the Word of God, brother, it goes across their grain. But we look at the Ten Commandments. We study the Ten Commandments, these ten injunctions that were given by God to Moses on Mount Sinai. These are the basis of the Mosaic Law, also called the Decalogue. And all laws were derived from this perfect foundation. It was soon realized by human beings in their history that they were going to have some laws in order to protect themselves and to govern themselves. If they had not made laws, then they would have annihilated themselves pretty quickly, because the evil heart will not stand for another person interfering in any way. There will be that hostility. There'll be that murder. There'll be that. And I know we're increasing in murders right now. I heard the other night. It's unbelievable how many murders are taking place every day in Chicago and out in Los Angeles and in Oregon and all these places where sin is running rampant. Murder is up by a great percentage. I can't remember what percentage, but way up. People are killing each other now. Well, if there were no laws, then, brother, they would be killing each other, wouldn't they? So we have laws. Now, Satan is a lawless person. He's a lawless personality, and his followers are also lawless. Evil men want to break the law so that they'll be free to lie, to steal, and to kill. And we have judges that let them do it. We have judges now on the benches that let these criminals go, and they don't worry about the victim. They are not concerned, in most cases, many cases, about the victim. So he got killed. So what? Let the criminal go. Let him have another chance. Let him live his life. Let him be happy. That's the attitude they have. That's the attitude some of our judges have. Brother, that's perverted. That is perverted. And if we would just remember and be reasonable and be sensible, we'd realize that if the Ten Commandments go, then all the other laws will soon go also. They'll go. Now, Mr. Judge out there, you sit on that bench with great authority. But don't you have a family? Don't you have children? Don't you care about them yourself? I mean, you know, you don't seem to care about ours. What about your own? One of these days, something's going to hit your home.
Right.
One of these days, it'll be one of your youngins. Now, what are you going to do then?
Right.
You better get awake now. Judges and lawyers and everybody better wake up in this country of ours. I may die tonight, but if I do, I'm going to die screaming, wake up, America. Wake up, America. Churches, wake up. Churches, wake up. Churches are not honoring God, my friend, no, because God is not their God. Oh, they want God's salvation, all right. They want to go to heaven, all right. But God don't bother me because I got to go play ball. Now, I'm going to tell you something, friend. We have gone sports crazy in America. You like that or not? That's not just my opinion. That's a fact. We've gone crazy over sports. Now, what if there were no laws to protect us from robbery? We'd be getting robbed every time we turned around.
Yep.
What if there were no laws about murder? People would really be killing each other, wouldn't they? Well, I appreciate the land of the free, a land that is free from tyranny and oppression. I appreciate a land that is freedom of speech and of expression. I appreciate a land free to work and to aspire and to search and to find better ways and to make better money and to have a better house and to better have land and have possessions, material things. I'm for a land like that. I appreciate a land like that. And I do not want a land with no absolutes. I want a land that believes in absolutes. Now, I want a land that will say with conviction of heart, God bless America. John 8:36, if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. He makes us free in our spirit, but also, you know why we've been free in America all these years? Because of the same Jesus.
Amen.
He's the one that gave us all the freedom that we have physically, mentally, and spiritually. Now, freedom is one of the greatest blessings that anybody could ever have. There is the freedom from tyrannical depression and dominance and political agendas. We've had freedom from that all these years. There is a spiritual freedom from the power of the devil. The devil can't get us anymore. He had us one day, I mean, lock, stock, and barrel. He had every one of us in his clutches. And we were doing what he wanted us to do. We were going where he wanted us to go. We were acting like he wanted us to act. But Jesus stepped in.
Amen.
And lifted us up out of that and set us free. Now, hallelujah, we can tell the devil to bug off. We can tell the devil, I no longer serve you. I no longer dance to your music. I'm telling you, I'm singing a new song. I've got a new name in heaven. My name is written down in heaven. That's what Jesus said. Not only did he say that, but he said, rejoice that your name is written. Well, glory to God. Hallelujah. I'm rejoicing tonight because my name is in heaven. And the reason I know it's there, Jesus cannot lie. He told us the truth. So my friends, some of these have no fear of God's chastisement. Church members, they're not afraid of God's chastisement. They're hoping it'll hold back a long time until they get through having their fun. But they're not really fearing it. But when it hits now, you're going to wake up and realize what a fool you've been if you're a born-again believer and you're backslidden on God. Some Americans have forgotten how important this national freedom is. Some Americans have forgotten how that their old sins have been purged. Some have forgotten how Jesus forgave them of all their sins. Now, some Americans have no fear of losing our freedoms completely to the socialists, because we've raised a group of people that sit on the couch with a blanket around them, with a telephone in one hand and the television on, and all that's on is kill, kill, kill. If you don't like somebody, go kill them. And that's what most of your video games are about, is killing, murder, slaughter, burning, looting, all of that. And our kids are being fed that day in and day out, day in and day out. And they got killing in their heart. They got killing on their mind. And we're training them that way and won't do one thing about it. Christian people won't do one thing about that. They let their kids watch anything. And I mean, I'm talking about bad stuff. Now, I don't watch any of it. I don't care a thing about a movie. I care nothing about people killing anymore. I love guns with all my being. But I can't stand to turn a program on and da 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 da. I can't stand that. Because that's killing somebody. It's betraying that. And so kids grow up under that influence. And you know, there's one good program that would be a real good program, and that's Gunsmoke, if they didn't advertise and push liquor. Like they do. Watch every Gunsmoke program. Somebody's got to get drunk. Somebody's got to say, you know, I need that drink. Or somebody's going to say, whenever the program comes out okay, they'll say, you know, how about let's go to the Long Branch and get us a drink. Yeah, that sounds good. Let's do that. And brother, these young people grow up under that influence. When I was little, I didn't understand that. Didn't realize it too much. But now, whenever I turn it on and I see Gunsmoke, sometimes I just turn it on. Because they're celebrating liquor. Watch it. I mean, watch it for yourself. You say, Sammy, you're going nutty. You're becoming a fanatic. Somebody better get fanatical.
Amen.
Somebody better wake up in this stupid country of ours. It's going stupid right now.
Amen.
It's losing. It's losing fast. So while we still have some fundamental Christians in this world, brother, she's still in bad shape. Although we have some conservative Americans in this world, it is still going downward. We have more and more compromisers in this world than we've ever had. Gavin Newsom, or whatever his name is, California, he should have been called out a long time ago.
Oh, yeah.
And they left that rascal in there, but Soros, among many, Soros gave $1 million to help keep him in there. Because he's got billions and he can throw a million around like I can't even throw a penny around. And so these millionaires, these billionaires, are paying big money to down this country,
right,
to keep the liberals in and to make sure the hell raisers stay in,
yep,
and keep on going away from God and away from the old American way. Now, if you can't see that, you got your head in the sand.
Amen.
So get it out. We have more and more compromisers than I've ever seen. I mean, you talk to them, bro, they compromise this word of God up one side, down the other. We have more socialistic minds now than we've ever had, and they're growing by leaps and bounds. Liberal professors in our colleges and universities are brainwashing our young people. Many of our young people have been, of course, raised in ease and laziness. Like I said, on the couch with a phone in one hand, the television remote in the other. And that's about the way they're raised. They're not made to get up and go cut wood or bring in the coal or like we used to have to do. They don't do any chores. They don't do any work. I mean, they just are lazy.
Yeah.
Well, listen, whenever somebody comes out with this, give college, free college, and give free this, and give free that, sounds good to that old boy.
Yeah.
I can stay on my couch and watch my video. I can be lazy. I don't have to work. I don't have to get up and go to work in the morning like a lot of people do. They're going to give me everything.
Amen.
But can you imagine when they keep giving and keep giving and keep giving, it's going to run out?
Right.
It'll run out somewhere pretty soon. And it'll be like Venezuela. It'll be like these other countries. Whenever it gives out, it gives out. Yeah. Then they starve to death. I mean, back, 50, 60 years ago, Castro was a hot thing. And Castro really got Cuba under communism. And led them under communism. Now you're seeing the Cubans are marching in the streets by the thousands, wanting us to free them, wanting us to give them their freedom. You know why? Because they don't have the necessary food to eat like we do. They don't have their shelves packed full like we do. They don't have the blessings like we do.
Yeah.
Communism has wrecked that place.
Right.
Brother, listen, and they want freedom. Many of them want to come to America. Everybody has wanted to come to America. That bridge down there in Texas, 11,000 now or more, are hovering around and under that bridge. And they're illegal, every one of them. They don't say one thing about wearing a mask.
Right.
They don't care one thing about checking them for COVID.
Amen.
They just let them come in and do whatever they want to do, and then they turn them loose into the entire
in
a country, throughout state after state after state, and they don't require them to do anything. Just come because we're looking for your boot one day. He said, Brother Sammy, your opinions don't agree with mine. You wait and see what old Ken says.
Amen.
You see what I say.
Right.
You watch what they're doing. I know what they're doing. I've seen this scheme before, and I see it now. Many don't realize that everything costs money, and that money's got to come from somewhere. But right now, it's coming from you, and it's coming from me. And that's where it'll continue to come from until we are broke, and we won't have anything. Taxes going up, more and more taxes. We're already paying high taxes in many of these jobs that have been a precious thing for the American people have disappeared. Many of those jobs are gone now, will never return. Many of these jobs will never be worked and found by anybody that's aspiring to be something or to do something. Our economy is very shaky. We are, as I said a while ago, entertainment crazy. Now, don't get mad at me. Look at yourself. I'm telling you, some of you sitting here right now may would rather look at your ball game than to go to church. Now, let me tell you this. I was sitting in Silver Bay one day, one Sunday after church, eating dinner, lunch, whatever you want to call it. But here came a teenage group of ball players, ball caps on. Their white pants were muddy where they'd been sliding into bases, you know. And this is just right after church, about 30 minutes after church lit out. They'd been playing ball instead of being in church. That is a sin unto God. That is terrible as it could be. That's as bad as getting drunk. You raise a kid like that, you might as well tell him to go out and raise hell, drink all the liquor you can drink, get on all the dope you can, and live it up till you die because you're going the wrong way. Those kids were out there laughing and cutting up and getting ready to pig out on some good old American vittles, good old American food God put on our shelf, put in our kitchen. Praise God, just dive in like a bunch of hogs, never look up one time and say, thank you, Lord. They're like a bunch of pigs eating acorns under an oak tree, eating those acorns, but never knowing where they come from. Brother, we are eating high the hog, high bin, and we don't even realize where our blessings are coming from. Every crumb you eat, you ought to say, thank you, Lord. Every drink of water you drink, you ought to say, thank you, Lord. Every time you put your head on a good clean sheet and pillow, you ought to say, thank you, Lord. God's blessed us. God's blessed us.
Amen.
And I love him for it. And I want to stand for him. And I want to tell you, he ought to have the preeminence. He ought to be number one. Liberal professors make me sick. Liberal teachers make me sick. We are entertainment crazy. Now, things that are not wrong. I'm talking about the entertainment itself is not wrong. There's nothing wrong with the ball game. I love them myself. I love sports. But not God, not for a God, I don't. I don't put them before my God. And then, of course, ball practice on Wednesday night. Schools do that. Why? Why? Keep those kids out of church. Hey, and like I said a while ago, playing ball on Sunday morning during church hours with a team dressed out, a uniforms on, pretty blue and white uniforms with their pretty ball caps, and they're just having a jubilee. And they're eating high on the hog, and God is not even thought of. The coach probably never had a word of prayer with them. I don't know that. I don't know that. Might as well not. But over in Colossians chapter 1, verse 18, he is to have the preeminence, God's word says. Now, that's the word. That's not an opinion. That's the word of God. Colossians 1:18. So then you can argue with that. You don't have a choice about this. You either accept it or you reject it. Now, we're considered fanatics when we take a stand for the scripture. And we're addicted to these things that they claim, these Bibles and these King James Bibles and all this blood religion and all that. And y'all are just a bunch of brainwashed people. We're not brainwashed, we're bloodwashed. Make a difference. But now these people in America now are addicted to these phones to the point that there's not much fellowship anymore. Back years ago when we would go see Uncle Sam or Uncle Elmer or something, we'd go and my daddy and Uncle Sam would sit there beside the barn or wherever, and they would talk for hours, just sit there and talk about farming, about this field and that crop, farmers. Sit and talk. We'd play in the yard. All of us kids would play in the yard. We may make a ring in the yard and shoot marbles or whatever. But we fellowship. My mama would be in the house with Aunt Bertha or those other aunts, and they'd be cooking or maybe fixing some ice cream. And I mean, it was a good old time as far as that goes, because we fellowship. But you go to visit somebody now, and you're sitting there and you want to talk to somebody, and they're sitting there. I got my wife and Edwin one night. Yeah, I'm going to tell you on them. They were sitting in the restaurant, you know, after church, and they were sitting there on that phone. Both of them had a phone. And I'm trying to talk to them. I just got up. I said, let me go out in the car. And I went out in the car and got my phone. I came back in. I sat down beside them. I started. I don't know if I was looking at anything. And Ann would say something to me, and I'd say, yeah, but sit down. Yeah. You know? Where's the fellowship? Yeah. Hey, if you're going to fellowship me, look at me.
Amen.
They taught me and Woodside Mill more than some of these Bible school teachers about ethics. One thing they taught us, when you're talking to somebody, look them in the eye. You don't have to make boo-boo eyes at them. You don't have to act a fool, but look them in the eye. Let them know you are listening to what they got to say, and you're talking to them so they can receive what you're saying. But if you're going to sit here like this, or you're going to stand over here and talk over here, and they're over there, they don't know what to expect. You got to learn some respect. We need to start in our kids. Bless your dear sweet mama's hearts and daddy's hearts, and you need to start teaching people some manners.
Yeah.
We got young boys, good Christian young boys. They don't even know how to walk with a girl. They'll walk like this. Where's my girl? She's got a This is his date. And he's running off and leaving her. She's following him like a little puppy dog. You know, if I catch up with that rascal, he's got longer legs than I got. I've seen it right here in this church. I've seen husbands come to that door and walk through the door and let the door go on his wife. That's not good. I'm not preaching all Bible. I'm preaching ethics too. When you come to that door with your wife, let her be in front of you, and you open that door for her and let her go before you. When you get out of that car, praise God, you wait on her and you walk with her. Now, whenever I get out of my car now, like for instance at the clock, there's a slant there. So I get out, I step up on that slant place because Ann got a bad foot, and I'll take her by the hand. But I had to get ahead of her to do that, to help her up. Now, I'm not talking about that. And whenever I had to step forward in front of her to open the door for her, I had to get in front of her. But as far as she and I walking down the road or whatever, she walks with me, beside me, not behind me. I've been married 61 years to her, and I still respect her as my wife. And I'm telling you right now, every man ought to do that. Every man ought to do that. I'm telling you, whether you're married to her or not, if you're dating her, praise God, treat her like a girl. And I don't care what this old modernist thing says, a girl's a girl, and a boy's a boy. Yeah. I don't believe in making a girl out of a boy or a boy out of a girl. I don't believe in changing anything. I believe in letting a boy be a boy and a girl be a girl. And some of you fathers ought to get your boys out when they're little and take them hunting and let them shoot a rabbit or shoot a squirrel. Somebody say, oh, you wouldn't shoot that little animal. Hey, shut your mouth. We had to live off of that when I was coming up. You didn't get it, you didn't eat.
Right.
You had to. And I can't stand these little people that say that we're criminals for shooting a rabbit to eat. I'm not going out there shooting for target practice and shooting them 1 foot off and shooting another foot off, making them something. I don't believe in cruelty, but if I want something to eat, I'll get it. Yeah. How do people eat deer? And you know what? One critic one time, Boy, I'm rambling. I know. I'll get off of this and quit. And I'll quit preaching on freedom for a while. But one lady was just giving me down the road because I kill squirrels. I don't know. I did. And I used to eat them. My wife can cook a squirrel better than a steak. And so I'm telling about it, you know, and I'm just happy that I can tell my wife knows how to cook. And she can cook a squirrel better than you've ever seen.
Amen.
And you'll eat it too, praise God. It ain't a rat. Somebody said, oh, it's just a big rat. Well, a rat, I'll kill it. If you kill me a rat, it eats that good, I'll eat it. But anyway, this lady just giving me down the road. And I said, let me ask you something. Be honest now. Have you ever eaten a steak? Well, sure. I eat them all the time. I said, you hypocrite. Do you know that was a cow at one time? Bigger than a squirrel.
That's right, bro.
That cow had feelings just like that squirrel had.
Amen.
And you're eating cow, and you don't think a thing about it because it feels your belly. But you want to criticize me because you don't like squirrels. You don't like rabbits. How'd I get on this, y'all? But you see how people strain at a gnat and swallow a camel?
Yep.
You see how people really go to the extreme and act silly and don't make sense? I mean, you know, I'm an old farm boy, and I got a little common sense. And I know when you're hungry, you got to get something to eat, right?
Right.
And I didn't go out and beg for it. I didn't go out and wait for the socialist people to hurry up and get together and start giving it to me. I went out and worked for it, hunted for it, and I brought it in. Brother Jim Burns and I, he used to be my song leader, we'd go squirrel hunting nearly every Tuesday morning if we had time. And he and I, in one season, killed 160 squirrels. What did you do with them? Throw them in the trash can? No, sir. We brought them home, and he and I helped him clean his. He helped me clean mine. He took his home, put them in the freezer. I put mine in the freezer. And every once in a while, I'd say, you know, I'd like to have one of those squirrels. Boy, she'd parable that thing, cook that thing up, fry it real good, and then cook gravy, cream gravy. Oh. With old brown biscuit. That ain't 15, is it? Let her fix it for herself. When we built this first, no, before we built this building down here at Sunday School Ben, we were out there, some of the church members and I, and Ann cooked a goat and put it in a big pot. I said in the middle of the time, she said, and don't tell anybody what that is. It was goat meat in gravy, brown gravy. And they sucked that bowl. I thought they was going to eat the peeling off the bowl. They sucked, I'm telling the truth. She knows, y'all know it, some of y'all were there. And they sucked that thing. When we got through, we said, you know what that was? They said, well, that was beef, wasn't it? It was goat. Goat. You ever eaten a goat? That's meat you ever put in your mouth.
Right, bro.
Well, I rambled, ran rabbits. You had a little bit of entertainment, maybe, but I'm just telling you, freedom. Free to do what you want to do. Don't tell me what I can do and can't do as long as I'm legal, as long as I'm doing the right thing, especially when I'm obeying this book. We got to stick with this. So God meant for us to be free, and he made us even a free moral agent. We can choose whether to be saved or not. We can choose whether we want to love him or not. He doesn't force us to love him. Now, what about that? He's the God that could say, you either do what I say or you're dead. But he doesn't. He gives us an opportunity to choose him or reject him. Now, brother, if God does that, this country ought to do it.
Amen.
They ought to give us our choice. Let's stand up to our feet. I hope you'll come back next week. Amen. I hope I'm not running people off, but I just got to get it off my heart.
Amen.
Because it's late. I believe in freedom. I believe God gave it to us, and we ought to really cherish it and really love it and appreciate it till we get home to glory. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for freedom. We thank you for this freedom we have in our spirit, that Jesus set us free, gave us this eternal life. He said, if Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. And indeed tonight, here we have a group of people free in their spirit because of what Jesus did for us on the cross.
Amen.
And Lord, let this plain preaching wake people up. Don't let it make them mad. Don't let it get them all upset. Don't let it split the church. But let it wake us all up to the reality that Jesus is supposed to be number one in all that we do. And our Father, help us to live that till we see you face to face. We give it all to thee in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.